Good morning, Trinity Christian Fellowship. Hope you're doing well today. I'm so glad that we get to gather together on this beautiful morning and worship the name of our Lord and Savior. I was unloading the drums here a little bit earlier this morning. I was looking out at the sky. I'm like, could I actually ask for better weather? Like, realistically? No, I don't think I could. It's such a beautiful day. We're glad that God gives us rain, but God also gives us this beautiful sunshine to enjoy as well. So with that, I invite you to stand. I'll give us an opening prayer, and we'll get started in a time of worshiping our Lord. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, holy are you. There is no one like you, God. We thank you, Lord, for this wonderful day that you've created. Thank you, God, for the blessing of life today, that we each got to wake up, that you brought us safely here, that we have the privilege of being in a place, in a country where we can worship you openly without fear of government persecution. And Lord, most of all, God, we thank you so much that you wanted us to be with you, that you sought relationship while we were in rebellion, and that you loved us enough to come down, live a sinless life, and offer yourself as a perfect sin offering for all of us. Lord, thank you so much for dying on the cross. Thank you, Lord, for tearing the veil of that temple and inviting Jew and Gentile alike into relationship with you. Thank you, Lord, as well, for rising from the grave, for giving us a hope of eternity with you, Lord, and for your gift of the Holy Spirit to be with us at all times, to instruct us and to guide us. So, Lord, this morning, we just want to say that we love you, and all of this praise that we're about to give is for you. May this be a pleasing sound to your ears. In your name we pray, Lord Jesus. Amen.
Your name, every blessing.
my boast.
I will make my boast in Christ alone. I will make my boast in Christ alone. I will make my boast in Christ alone.
God is worthy. On Christ the solid rock I stand.
On Christ the solid rock I stand. All of the ground. Your faithfulness, great is your love, oh God. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. Great is your faithfulness, great is your love, oh God. Rock of Rock of ages, you will stand.
You may be seated. And now we'll have Brother Mike Langham bring us our communion devotion this morning.
Good morning.
I'm going to read from 1 John 1. It's the New King James Version, starting with verse 5. This is the message which we have heard from him and declare to you that God is light, and in him is no darkness at all. I used to read this thing, you know, it says that God is light. In other words, God is without sin. And that's not what it means. And in him is no darkness, sin. But light is simply the truth. That God is truth, and in him is no deceit at all. If we say that we have fellowship with him and walk in darkness, walk in lies, we lie and do not practice the truth. But if we walk in the light as he is in the light. I used to always think that too. Well, gosh, if I am sinless, like God's sinless, that doesn't make any sense either. We have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus Christ, his son, cleanses us from all sin. Not some, all. If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. So when I read that part, I did away with what I thought the first time. He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from some unrighteousness or all unrighteousness. All, everything. If we say that we have not sinned, we make him a liar. Don't do that. And his word is not in us. Father, we thank you that you forgave us all of our sins. Not some, not just the real bad ones. They're all bad to you, Lord. But you hung on that cross 3 days, rose in 3 days, God, and you destroyed the evil one. Oh, he's still around. He's still trying to come into our lives and mess him up and tell us that we're not saved, tell us that we've sinned too much. But God, you covered everything for those that believe. Every sin, God, every sin, every thought, Lord, you covered. Lord, we thank you and praise you for that. God, your word says whoever believes in you will have eternal life. Not might, not temporary life, eternal life, God. And we thank you for that. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.
When I walk through deep waters, I know that you will be with me. When I'm standing in the fire, I will not be overcome. Through the valley of the shadow, I will not fear. I am not alone. I am not alone. You will go before me. You will never leave me. I am not alone. I am not alone. You will go before me. You will never leave me. In the midst of deep sorrow, I see your light is breaking through. The dark of night.
forsake me. I am pressing into you. Lord, you fight my every battle.
Good morning, Trinity Christian Fellowship. I love you. Glad you could come join me in my backyard. Beautiful spring day. Thankful for so many blessings God has sent our way. Let's go to God in prayer right now. Heavenly Father, we're grateful for so many things that we lose sight of. Right now, I hear a lot of traffic going on by. I'm thankful for people who have jobs and responsibilities and the things they do. Lord, I'm also thankful for the sound of the birds chirping. Lord, I'm thankful for roses growing right behind me. Thankful for just a little patch of earth in an otherwise very busy Bay Area. Lord, thank you for these blessings. Thank you for the health that we have. Thank you for the friends that we have, the family that we have, our church. Thank you for our country. Thank you for the good rain and the snow that we've had and the prospects for our food in the future. Thank you for all these blessings, God. We are truly grateful. It all comes from your hands, and we can't manage it on our own. Lord, thank you. And Lord, always help us to express our gratitude to you, thanking you as Jesus taught us how to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Turn in your Bibles to the book of Jeremiah. Jeremiah chapter 9, verses 23 and 24. Two verses that are the basis of a song that we already sang just a little bit ago. And in the context, though, that we're going to be looking at it, it talks about how to get out of trouble and the things that people do to try to get out of trouble. I remember hearing a story joke when I was a kid. And I've heard several variations of the same thing since. But the variation that I heard was a little boy, after walking home from school, on the way home, he saw a swimming hole, decided to get on in, took his shoes off, dove in. His parents caught him there and said, "You can't do this. This is unsafe. It's not your swimming hole. Don't ever do this again." He said, "Fine, I won't." Next day, he's walking. He goes off by the same swimming hole and takes his shoes off, dives right in. His parents are on to him this time. They are there right away, and they catch him. And they said, "You went into the swimming pool. You wanted to go swimming." He said, "No, I didn't. I fell in." And then the parents looked down and they saw his shoes untied, nicely placed by the side of the swimming hole. And they said, "Well, then how is it you were able to take your shoes off before you fell in?" And he said, "Because I'm quick." Obviously, that couldn't be it. The thing is, people have all sorts of different ways of trying to get out of trouble, explaining their way out, whatever. And Judah had God in their lives before, but frankly, they wanted God to stay in his lane and not be poking his nose into their business all the time. So they had ways of sidelining God and other ways to try to manage their national crises. Let's read the passage, then we're going to see the different ways people address these situations. This is what the Lord says: "Let not the wise boast of their wisdom, or the strong boast of their strength, or the rich boast of their riches. But let the one who boasts boast about this, that they have the understanding to know me, that I am the Lord who exercises kindness, justice, and righteousness on earth. For in these I delight, declares the Lord." In this passage, it mentions three kind of popular assets that people of that time thought could get them out of trouble, nationally or personally. It talks about the wise man or the scholar. Everybody wants to go to a good school, right? Get a good education. The strong man, the athlete, the warrior, sure. The rich man, the financier. Those things were highly esteemed back then. They're highly esteemed now. So I guess time hasn't changed a whole lot. Last one sticks out to me, the richest, because oftentimes people, you know, the wise man thinks he can figure his way out of a problem. The strong man thinks he can fight his way out of a problem. And the rich man thinks he can buy his way out of a problem. In Proverbs chapter 23, verses 4 and 5, talking about riches, it says this: "Do not wear yourself out to get rich. Have the wisdom to show restraint. Cast but a glance at riches, and they are gone, for they will surely sprout wings and fly off to the sky like an eagle." Have you ever had money fly away from you? You know, sometimes I remember taking kids and getting them enrolled in school, and you start writing those checks for tuition and housing and books. And yeah, I could just hear the fluttering of the dollar bills just flying right out of my bank accounts. Stock market takes a hiccup, they fly away. Riches do fly away. The Babylonians were coming. You think you're dollars is going to keep the Babylonians at bay? This is what Jeremiah is trying to tell the people of Judah. The context there: how do you try to get out of trouble? For some of us, we might think, well, you know, I can talk my way out of trouble. I can charm my way out of trouble. I'm strong. I can outlast the bad times. Well, maybe so. I have connections. Daddy always bails me out. I'm the luckiest dude in the world. I don't know. I get in trouble and somehow miraculously I get out of it. There's all sorts of strategies and characteristics people think they have at their disposal, their assets to get out of trouble. What do you use? It tells us in the next section what needs to be our starting point and our number one consideration from that all our strategies spring from that one thing. And what is that one thing? It says, they have the understanding to know me, that I am the Lord. Knowing God. Okay? That's not just step one. That is the whole strategy, and everything springs from that knowledge. that solves the problems that we happen to be getting into. Paul quotes this passage twice in his letters to Corinthians, 1 Corinthians and 2 Corinthians. In 2 Corinthians, he's dealing with competitors. Paul started the church in Corinth. He brought a lot of people to Jesus. He taught a lot of people. He wrote books to the church in Corinth. But competitors would come along. People who thought this Christian thing is getting to be a pretty good thing. I'm a Christian, but I'm going to see if I can make a few denarii myself out of this. And so some wanted to mix in a little bit more of Judaism with it. Others wanted to do a little bit more of Greek religion with it and so forth, make it into something else. And they would run down Paul and promote themselves. Paul says in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 17, where he quotes our passage today, he says, "But let the one who boasts boast in the Lord. For it is not the one who commends himself who is approved, but the one whom the Lord commends." Paul is saying, why should anybody go around endorsing themselves? Honestly, have you ever heard of a politician have a special news conference and I have a new endorsement to make? I endorse me. Well, what's that worth? It's worth nothing. Paul is saying, you live your life. You let God be the one who says whether you're good or bad. You leave your burdens, your image to God. Anybody who gets to the place in which they're always defending themselves, always a defensive person, always vindicating themselves and blaming everybody around them, becomes a person no one wants to be around. It's very self-defeating. Be the person focused on God. Let God be the one who gives the narrative about you. Don't be the person who's always running down other people and patting yourself on the back. It is not a good look. It isn't. So when we're in trouble, it says focus on God. Now, I don't want to get cliche about this. Oftentimes, people get in trouble and other people say, oh, just give it to God. Again, which is good. It is good. What this passage is trying to underscore, though, in general, that if the Lord is your God, He is your focus from the beginning, not just the end. God is not just a rescuer, which is at the end. He is also a preventer who is there at the beginning. God wants to take care of a whole lot of problems, not just when He's dashing you through the flames to get out of a burning building. He would like to be there at the beginning before the fire even starts. You know, there's some people that might just fret over this big credit card bill that they get. And God, I can't afford it. And they're going to foreclose on me, blah, blah, blah. God, help. And God is a rescuer. He is. But a question needs to be asked. Were you that focused on God when you were racking up the debt? When you're on the shopping spree, if that was the case. Now, I understand a lot of debt that does happen is not on anybody's fault. Just trying to survive. Understand that. But there's a lot of things that can be done differently. And it's at that point that God would like to be God too, to be Lord too, to be the controlling influence of your life as well. Before the problem starts, not just after at the rescuer time. And Jesus was this in many respects. Jesus, while He Himself died on the cross from persecution, His followers did. But in many respects, Jesus did save people way before they knew there was a problem in the things that He said. For instance, He would say unpopular things like pay your taxes, give to Caesar what is Caesar's, to God what is God's. He'd also say, you know, if somebody requires you to carry their load 1 mile, can't let them carry it 2 miles for them. That was a reference to what the Roman centurion or soldiers could require any person to do, carry their load for a mile. Do it too. In other words, Jesus was saying, don't tick off the Romans. Don't. Submit. They're in charge. They're bigger and stronger than you. Don't pick a fight with them. So this got into the Christian's head during Jesus' time. Later on, it gets closer to 70 AD, and as it's getting there, there's a spirit of rebellion going on in Judah. They want to fight the Romans. And the Christians are not cool with this because they were remembering what Jesus said, how to treat the Romans. The Christians got nervous in Jerusalem and they left. They knew what was going to happen. And sure enough, 70 AD came around And full-on battle came. The Romans came in, destroyed the temple, destroyed Jerusalem. The whole Masada thing happened. And a decree went out that was observed for centuries that Jewish people could not be in Jerusalem anymore back then. Oh, the Christians got, Jesus saved them 40 years before the event ever happened. The Christians had it in their mind, and it got them out of the trouble. The people who did not listen are the ones who paid the heaviest price. Jesus is a preventer as well as a rescuer. We need to always keep that in our head. Proverbs chapter 9, verse 10, it says, "The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom." The beginning. Knowledge of the Holy One is understanding. Jesus doesn't want to be just the solution at the end of the thing. He's at the beginning, square one. Oh, many times I've had to cut some wood, firewood, trim up some limbs. If I'm using my saw, if it's a dull saw, a chainsaw, for instance, it takes a long time to sharpen a chainsaw. You have this little file, it's like cleaning, a dental hygienist cleaning each little tooth. It takes a while. You know what takes longer? Trying to do a job with a dull saw. It doesn't work good. It takes a long time. You need to do certain things at the beginning of the problem, not just slowly go through an ill-advised way of doing things. Do things at the beginning. Jesus said, Matthew chapter 6, verse 33, "Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and everything else will be added to you." Put him first at the beginning. Don't just wait for the rescuer. He is a rescuer. But let him be Lord at the beginning, too, when you're dealing with problems. The third thing, it talks about the assets that God appreciates. If we're making him first, three assets he appreciates: kindness, justice, righteousness. First one, kindness, or some translations put it, loving kindness. Very important Hebrew word, chesed. Chesed. Loving kindness. Doesn't mean just love or kindness in general. It means love or kindness to a specific category of people. People you have a relationship with, a covenant with. One of the most important words in the Old Testament in Hebrew, chesed. Covenant, loving kindness. You love people that have a relationship with you in a way that you don't love just a standard guy. Yes, does God love everybody? Yes, he does. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. But there's a certain kind of love, a chesed love, that only happens with the people that love him back, that join with him in that category back, who have a relationship, who don't leave him standing at the altar. No, they're the ones who are committing to him, and there's a special love that they have that the others don't have. You know, oftentimes we get very egalitarian, you know, God loves everybody the same. No, he does not. He does not. He loves everybody, yeah. But there's a special chesed. Here in the backyard, when we first moved into our place here, the ground was sloped toward the house. That's not good for drainage. You don't want it to drain toward the house. And so I graded it away the other direction, creating a lower spot in the back. And I knew full well that all the adjoining properties are going to drain my direction because I created a low spot. And that's fine. I created a basin in that, put a sump pump at the bottom of that, which pumps water from that low spot up a pipe and then out to the street. And there have been so many storms coming on through and rain that I'd come home and my backyard is well drained. And I say, I love my sump pump. It saved me so many problems. I love my sump pump. My wife probably has gotten tired of hearing me saying, I love my sump pump. Hope she doesn't get jealous. The thing is, my children have heard me say this, and I've said I love you many times to them. And you know, they've never said back, yeah, I know you love me, Dad. But then again, you love your sump pump. Yeah, I love my sump pump. But that's nothing compared to the chesed, the special kind of love you have with somebody that you have a connection with. It doesn't go to everybody. It does not. And God has a chesed for you if you have a covenant with him, if you're loving him back. He has a special chesed for you. Many movies have come and gone about some kid or spouse who's, you know, a kid that's parent is a community figure, and they're always at every fundraiser, they're at every community event, anybody needs a hand, they're out helping them, blah, 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 and they're gone all the time. And junior has a ball game, the parent's not there. Junior has a band recital, parent isn't there. Junior has a birthday, parent isn't there. Get the idea. Junior sure wishes there was such a thing as chesed in his life, that he was somehow special to somebody besides just along with everybody else in the community. God has that. If you have the love for him and you are connected with him, you have a covenant with him, he's there at your birthday party. Wouldn't miss it for the world, because he has chesed. The two other things he mentions quickly: one, justice. That's highlighted in one of my favorite passages in the book of Micah, chapter 6, verse 8. He says, "He has shown you, O man, what is good, and what does the Lord require of you, but to act justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God." Justice, to be the fair person at all times, even when it's detrimental to your well-being, to be fair to the other, that you are a fair person. And the last one, righteousness. Righteousness is behavior motivated. It is not talking about a person who behaves by not doing anything wrong. It's more about always doing many things, and the thing that you do is right. Doing, behavior, righteousness. No manipulation, no deceit, no doing things at other people's expense, no tricks. Wholesomeness, to be the person that, in this tainted world, we feel dirtied enough. Some of us feel like welcome mats other people scrape their stuff on. We feel defiled and dirtied by other people. But when you come into contact with a person whose cause is righteousness, and everything they do is absolutely wholesome, you walk away from that conversation feeling cleaner than you walked in into it. Righteousness is so redeeming for the individual as well as the people around. Well, there we have it. Different ways of hassling with trouble. There's a couple different ways and troubles in which we're never going to get out of, we're going to experience. One is just general pain that happens in the world. Dog-eat-dog world, we're all going to get bit, okay? The ways of this world, everybody has some degree of suffering. No two ways around that. Another thing for Christians, or other people too, but persecution. Jesus knew what it was like to be persecuted. His followers knew what it was, his disciples knew what it was like to be persecuted. And unfortunately, there's no way around that. Know that Jesus knows what that feels like. But there is a kind of pain or trouble that we can get out of. We can manage a little bit. And that is some of the things that are of our own doing. And it's in that situation, I want us to know that, yes, Jesus is there and he can rescue. He wants to rescue. But even better than being rescued at the last moment is for him to be the Lord all along. Because God would just as soon try to keep you from that hour of trial to start with. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for this time in this backyard. And thank you that you've given us hope in Jesus. Walk with us, talk with us, give us the right brain cells, focus the right direction, order our steps to be in lockstep with you, so that we're not only walking with you, but we're also walking in a pretty good path and a pretty good strategy that helps steer clear of a lot of the avoidable hardship of this life. There is plenty of hardship that is not avoidable, but Lord, be our shepherd, guide us through the stuff that is avoidable. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. Now let's say our benediction together. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen. God bless.
your Messiah, Redeemer.